The scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, Sermon on the Mount. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. May the Lord bless to our hearts and our minds this reading of His Word. I'm very excited today because we are beginning an 8-week journey through the Sermon on the Mount. We're not going to do the Beatitudes because I've done those recently. We're going to start right in after them, the first 8 verses, and go through Matthew 5, 6, and 7, which is the most concentrated ethical teaching of Jesus in the Bible. Most scholars don't believe that this was one sermon that was said on one particular day that was transcribed, but it is a collection of Jesus' teachings put together and assembled by Matthew as an example of the teachings that he gave to his disciples during his life. And it's really the core of Christianity, and so I'm delighted that we're going to have a chance to look at his teachings in the Sermon on the Mount in the next 8 weeks. Mark Twain famously said about the Bible that it's not the parts he doesn't understand that bother him, it's the parts that he does understand. And I can see what he was talking about, because there are parts of the Sermon on the Mount that are very understandable, but are very difficult. They're troubling in some ways. And many people over the years have discounted these teachings, said that they're impossible, that no one can do this. How can you live your whole life and not be angry? How can you live your life with never a lustful thought? Even St. Jimmy Carter couldn't do that. And other people have said, well, maybe they're not impossible, but they're just not practical. It's no way to run a life, no way to run a country. I had a rabbi friend in Southern California when I lived there, and we would get together and have coffee and talk about our faiths together. And one time he said to me, you know, Bill, I'd say 90% of the things that Jesus said are totally acceptable in the Jewish religion. I would totally agree with 90% of what he said. I said, well, give me an example of what you don't agree with. And he said, that whole thing about when somebody hits you on the right cheek, you're supposed to turn the other cheek. That's stupid, he said. The whole thing about you're supposed to treat your enemies the same way you treat your friends? That doesn't make any sense. He was objecting to these teachings of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. It's interesting, you know, the people who founded this church 105 years ago, and they wrote the creed of the church, they agreed with the teachings of Jesus, and they thought that they were not only practical, but they were necessary. Let me read you from our creed. It says this: we believe that the adoption of the principles of Christianity would solve all the domestic and social problems of cities, states, or nations. That if we just adopted these principles that Jesus taught, it would solve our problems in our country, in our cities, that they really are vital for living. So as we go through the Sermon on the Mount these next few weeks, we'll see if we still believe that, how much we believe that these principles are the ones to live by that would really make our country work again. We have to understand that the Sermon on the Mount is tough because it goes against the grain. It goes against the grain of what our culture calls normal common sense. Jesus goes against the grain of good business practices. You know, 60% of his teachings were about money. And when he talks about money, it's not the way that we would ever run a business. The business would go bankrupt if we lived the way that Jesus talked. Jesus goes against the grain of what your parents taught you, that your job, where all we want is for you to be happy, to get an education so that you can be financially secure. That's totally different from Jesus' goal for people's life. Jesus goes against the grain of what is taught in most churches in America. Churches that preach judgment, not grace. Churches that give pat answers rather than leading people on a journey. Churches that exclude people based on their gender or their sexual orientation. So we're going to be wrestling with some of the paradoxes that are in these texts. Like, for example, our text today tells us to let our light shine so that the world can see our good works. In just a few verses, he's going to say the opposite. He's saying, do your good deeds in secret so that not even your right hand knows what your left hand is doing. Interesting. Which is it? We're going to understand that when Jesus teaches, he's primarily concerned with the motives behind people's actions. The same actions done from different motives can lead to different moral outcomes. So Jesus is very concerned with the motives behind our actions. This is not a new list of commandments. He is not giving a whole another 10 commandments. He's trying to describe what a life lived in God's presence would look like. So with that in mind, let us begin by recognizing that Jesus calls us to be resident aliens. We're called to be in the world, but not of the world. We're called to march to a different drum. The difference isn't in how we talk, but how we walk. We're called to think and to do things differently from the conventional thinking of our culture. Steve and I were talking this week about what music would go well with this sermon, and we came up with this song that you just heard. I'm just a poor, wayfaring stranger, traveling through this world of woe. That's another way of saying I'm a resident alien. But the song only has it half right, because in the song, the goal is just to get through this world and get to heaven as soon as you can, and then you're going to see your family and you're going to be with God. Everything's going to be okay. But according to Jesus, the goal while we're here as resident aliens is to do everything that we can to make this world a better place. So we know that it's not our home. We know we're here just in a temporary way. But while we are here, we want to invest ourselves in doing everything that we can to make this a better place. We're like renters who care. We care about the place. We care. We know that we don't own it and we're not going to be here forever, but we want to make this as good a place as we possibly can. And the images that Jesus uses are that we are to be salt and light. Salt. Why didn't Jesus say, you are the sugar of the world? I mean, sugar is great, isn't it? You take something that's sour or bitter, you put sugar on it, and it makes it better. It's a great thing. But salt. Well, salt it gives food flavor. It's also irritating. If you get salt in a wound or a cut, it hurts. But the reason he chose that metaphor is because in Jesus' day, in a world without refrigerators and ice and those kind of things, salt was the thing that preserved goodness. Salt is what you used to preserve the goodness in food. Without salt, when you slaughtered a lamb or a pig, very soon it would go bad. But if you could salt your meat, you could preserve the goodness for a long, long time. So the job of a Christian, as we're salt in the world, is to find good things and try to preserve them the best that we can. To do the very best that we can to preserve good things. And then to be light in a dark world. In a place where there is no light, we're to shine the light of God's love so that other people can see the way to go, see the way to live, see what to do. Sacrificial love, not the sword or brute power, will finally win out. That's what Jesus taught. And God will bless America the day America relearns that lesson, that by love and service, and not by brute power, will we win the hearts of other nations. Right now, we're in the slow group in learning that. But we need to understand that the triumph of right is assured not by violence or force, but by the power of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we are to be the light of the world. Not try to be it, not consider being it, but just be it. Because you are the only Bible some people will ever read. Do you know that when people look at you and they know you're a Christian, you're basically a witness to the Bible. Because a lot of people don't read the Bible, but they observe other people who do and who care about it. And according to how they live their life, they can be positive or negative toward your faith. They made a movie this year of a very famous children's book, Madeline L'Engle's book, A Wrinkle in Time. And it reminded me of a time many years ago when I did an interview with her for a Christian magazine, because she was a Christian. And I was talking to her, and we got on the subject of the church. And she said, "The church, oh, it's awful, isn't it? But it's all we have." It's awful, but it's all we have. We're to be just flawed people. We're just to do the very best that we can to be representatives of God, to be this light and salt in the world. Once a man, an African, was relieved of pain because of a surgery that was performed on him by a European doctor. And the man asked the doctor afterwards, he said, "Why have you come all this way to be with us in Africa?" And Dr. Albert Schweitzer said, "Jesus sent me. Jesus sent me." Schweitzer later said in his book, Quest for the Historical Jesus, that we cannot know a lot about the history of Jesus. It is shrouded in mystery. But he said that if you do what Jesus said to do in the Sermon on the Mount, if you live that way, Jesus will actually find you in the midst of living out his message. It's kind of a mystical thing, he said, that he comes to us as one unknown. He comes to us in the midst of living his life. I know many of you who've been to Mexico and have had that amazing experience on Thursday, that when the house is done and you have the key ceremony and you hand the key to the family and they're all there and the tears are flowing and they have a house for the first time in their life. And as the kids and the adults are walking back to the vans and loading in for the ride back, many have told me that's the closest I've ever felt to God in my entire life. Because they lived out the last 4 days. They lived out the message of the Sermon on the Mount. When you do that, you feel the closeness of God in your own life. That's how it happens. And then we're supposed to understand that we don't have to be the big light, we can be the little lights of this world. There's an old hymn that we used to sing when I was growing up in the Church of Christ called "Let the Lower Lights Be Burning." And I never really understood what that was about. So I looked it up, and it's a story from a true incident that happened in the late 1800s. There was a ship on Lake Erie that was trying to come into Cleveland Harbor. And it was a dark night, it was stormy. There's a lighthouse there. And as the ship got closer, he yelled to the lighthouse keeper, "Is this Cleveland?" "Yes." "Where are the lower lights?" "They're out." "Can you make the channel?" He said, "We must try or perish." So they tried to move the boat into the narrow channel there. But there were no lower lights burning to show the way, and the boat crashed on the rocks, and some people died. And the evangelist Dwight Moody took that, and in one of his sermons he said, "God will take care of the lighthouse. Our task is to keep the lower lights burning." The little lights along the shoreline. We don't have to be the big lighthouse, but through acts of love and service and grace, we can be those little lights which guide people to safety. I didn't understand that as a child, but this man named Bliss came along and wrote the hymn. And the words go like this. "Brightly beams our Father's mercy from his lighthouse evermore. But to us he gives the keeping of the lights along the shore. Eager eyes are watching, longing for the lights along the shore. Let the lower lights be burning. Send a gleam across the wave. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman you may rescue, you may save. Don't worry about being the lighthouse. Just be content to be one of the lower lights along the shore. There's a story that I love that happened, a true story, toward the end of the time of the Cold War, when they, just before the Berlin Wall fell and the Soviet Empire disintegrated. Back in those days, there was West Germany and East Germany. And East Germany, at that time, was governed by a communist dictator state. They were controlled by the police, the Stasi. People yearned for freedom. The desire for freedom was building and building and building. But in 1989, they were still controlled by that oppressive government. But people started to protest. They would gather in front of a church in Leipzig called St. Nicholas Church, and they would bring candles and they would sing songs. And they got larger and larger, and the gatherings became larger and larger. And then one night they started marching down the street, and people flocked out of their apartments. They brought their candles with them. They came down, and pretty soon there were 70,000 people in the streets of Leipzig singing and holding candles. It wasn't long after that the wall fell. The police later said, "We planned everything. We anticipated everything. Except for those candles. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine." And you know, never know what that little light can do in people's lives. You know what? I've always used the metaphor of a football game for the church. I said that the church is like a football game, and what you got to do is get out of the stands, get out of the luxury boxes, get out of the bleachers, and get on the field, because that's where the game is played. So I invite everyone who's here today, who's not on the field, who's not doing some of these things we're talking about, to join in. Now, in so many ways, this church is already a light in darkness and already salt in a little dusty suburb of Lilongwe, Malawi. There's a church called Kafida, and your church is a common name there. Everyone knows Piedmont Community Church. Last year, when they had a terrible famine, we raised $15,000, and thousands of people who didn't have food in that church were helped. There's a little place for orphans in a town called Empanela, and those kids are fed every day and taken care of because of gifts from the alternative gift market here. There's hospitals at Embangwini and Nkoma where people are, their lives are saved because of the light that you have shown in those places. There are girls and young women in Thailand who are saved from prostitution and child sex slavery because of the International Justice Mission, because of our kids club, our fifth and sixth graders who raise money to try to be a light in the world to those people's lives. You're a light in the world in Berkeley to the men who live at the homeless shelter there, and in City Team. You're a light in the world in Oakland where people are tutored through Faith Network and kids are helped along. You're a light of the world to each other. When somebody dies in this congregation and you rally around that family and support them in their grief and help them, you're a light of the world when you do that. Or when someone gets cancer and people bring food and the food angels appear, all of that is a way of being the light in the world and the salt of the earth. It's our job. That's what we're supposed to be about. We are God's resident aliens, but while we are here, we're going to do the very best we can to shine his light into dark places. Amen.